Hello everybody, this is DBZero, the developer of the Android Netrunner plugin, and I'm making this video to explain how to use this plugin most comfortably to play this game on Octagon. The plugin will focus on using the Octagon engine and not playing Android Netrunner itself. I assume you will all be familiar with the rules already. And hopefully at the end of this video, you'll be able to use the plugin in the most efficient method. So, first things first, let's take it from the start. The very first thing you do is loading your deck. So, on the top of the plugin, you can get the load deck function. So, let's start with one of the starting decks. I'm assuming you will going to have a folder in your hard disk where you will going to be storing your constructed decks, and once you have them, there will be no ID. Just double click on them to load it. So as the corporation, let's start with the Jinteki, and for the runner, let's pick the Hanark. Okay, so let's explain a bit the general user interface. At the middle of the game, we have the game board. The blue area is for the corporation, the red area is for the runner. Depending on which side you are, you will see the screen opposite to the other player, and the cards will face you. On the bottom, we have the player tabs. This first tab is yourself, and you can click on the other tab and see the details about the other player. So the very first tab will always be you. On the tabs you can see summary for how much credits, cards, agenda points, tags, and base links and bad publicity the other player has. So you can quickly check the other player's status. Below that you have your counters, and this basically is how many resources or basically the status of your game at any moment. So this is your clicks counter, how many clicks you have remaining in the turn. This is your credits counter, how much money you've got. This is your MQ counter. This is only used by the runner. It tells you how many more programs you can install. This is your base link, you use it to avoid traces. This is your agenda points, how many points you have gathered as a runner corporation. Bad publicity, only useful for the corporation, and counts how many bad publicity you've gathered. Your hand size, this is modified by brain damage usually. And finally the tags, again only useful for the runner, it counts how many times you've been tagged. Don't forget to check how many tags you have there, because otherwise the corp, you know, can do very nasty things to you. Okay, now below that we have your groups, which is your hand. If you mouse over the icon of everything, you will tell you what it is, so your HQ/grip. Then here we have your deck, your R&D and stack. Next we have your heap or archives, face up. And finally you have your face down archives, which is only useful for the corporation. If you want, you can hide any of these if you don't want to see it, but I suggest keeping them open. When you first load the game, you're going to have your full deck on your deck pile and your identity in your hand. Don't move any of these cards away. The game is going to set them up automatically. In the general way you use the plugin is that you right click on the table and you can see the various options that you have. And you can also right click on a card and get a slightly different set of options. So if you right click on my hand, I only get the HQ/grip options, but if I right click on my card, I get also special card actions. Also, most of the actions in the game have a shortcut. So you can see the shortcuts on the side of each card. So you can see that to pay and install a card is the enter key. To trust or archive a card is the delete key. Same on the table. You can see the shortcuts here. So the very first thing you want to do is setting up your game. How to do that is very simple. You right click on the table, go to the game option. In the game menu you find the most generic functions about the game. You probably don't use this menu at all, except to use the setup function. So this is the very first thing you do every game. You press that, the game loads for a bit. This is basically downloading your scripts, and then you get the very first time in a session, you will get this pop-up window. This window will either contain a message of the day and a did you know tip, or a new version information. For now, since the new version available, we get the message of the day. The message of the day is on the top, and afterwards you can see some did you know tips. This is to help you give you some information about other projects I have, or hints on tips and tips how to play this game. So you can usually just press no. Now, if you saw here, it quickly went through your deck and checked for your deck legality. And then it populated the chat box about what just happened. So it fetched your scripts, it checked your deck, it informs your opponent that your deck is okay, it informs which corporation you're playing, you shuffle your HQ, your R&D, and you drew your starting hand. Both players have to set up their game before you can do anything else. So let's go to the runner side, and the same game setup. Loads a bit. This one was a bit faster. No. Sometimes, if you notice in the chat box, you may get this warning. Warning, cannot download new scripts. This may happen if you have a network delay or if you are offline from the internet. Do not panic. This is just to inform you that the game will use the locally stored scripts. 99% of the case, this will be current. So there's nothing to worry about. Here is a little tip. You can expand this chat window so you can get everything in one line, which should make it slightly easier to read. Let's do the same thing on the corporation side. It's a bit tricky to put the arrow in the right place. There we go. Mostly you don't have more than 5 cards in your hand, so all this real estate is not used, especially if you have a widescreen monitor. Now, the game has started, and we're going to see some of the basic functions that are common on both players. After setup, you get your first 5 cards in your hand. If you like your cards, there's nothing else you need to do. Just inform your opponent. You can just click on the chat menu and say ready. The other player can look at their hand. If you do not like your hand, you can mulligan. You should only do this once per game. And to mulligan, just right click in your hand and select the mulligan option. The game will confirm that you want to mulligan in case you did it by mistake. And then we'll reshuffle your deck, your cards back into your deck, and we'll draw 5 new cards for you. Now that you have your starting hand, it's time to start the game. As always, the corporation goes first. To start your turn, you use the turns and clicks function, declare start of turn, which is the F1 button, conveniently. So, to start your turn, you see merely press F1. F1 will take all the mandatory actions you need to take. For example, if you're a corporation, it will manually draw a card for you. It will automatically draw a card for you. And it will also do any start of turn automations, like a pad campaign or a Adonis campaign. So let's go ahead and press that now. Now, pay close attention to the chat box. The chat box provides all the important information for you and your opponent. Things that you announce or that the game wants you to pay attention to are in black. Black is basically whatever you are doing. Everything that is on a different color, usually green or red, is what your opponent is doing. So everything you see in a different color than black is something that your opponent did in the game. So if you miss what's going in the game, you can always use the chat box to go back and even go back and see what happened in the previous few actions. The game will always record what is going on, so there is no chance for your opponent to take some money or do something without you noticing, as long as you have an eye on the chat box. So very important, keep your eye here. Now, as soon as you start your turn, the very first turn, you will get this little blue thing. This is used to signify whose turn it is, and it's conveniently in the middle so that it grabs your attention. Unless you see this button, the turn has not properly swapped. So make sure that you always use your F1 to start your turn. Before I continue further, I want to point out something important. When you right-click on the table or on a card, you will see one of the options is always bolded. If you right-click on this card, you see this is bolded. When you see a bolded action, this means it's the ability that will trigger when you double-click on the card. So in this case, double-clicking on one of your cards in your hand will play and install a card. If you double-click on a card on the table, it will use a card ability. Or it will clear the card if it's marked as being used. So most of everything you want to do, you can do with a double click. This makes the game quite intuitive to play, because most of the time you're just going to be double clicking your cards to do what you expect them to be doing. So keep that in mind, it will make your game go much, much faster. A very common action that you will be doing during the game is drawing a card. How do you draw a card? You mouse over your deck and you can right click to draw a card. Or you can simply double click. Now, as you can see, I'm a corporation, I drew one card, which automatically used up one action, as is per the rules of the game. You can see on the chat menu that the game informs a click was used, my name, and I've used my first click to draw a card. You see my clicks counter went less, and the card is in my hand. It works exactly the same way for the runner. Double click on your deck, draw a card. If you want, you can press Ctrl D, but double click is usually easier. Another very common action for both players is naturally to take a credit with a click. To do that, right click on the table, click, receive a credit. You see it on the chat box, and once you played a few times, you can easily do it with Ctrl C. Just keep in mind a slight bug Octagon has. Don't do a lot of actions very quickly. So don't press Ctrl C in rapid succession 3 times. The behavior might be a bit erratic and you might see that you got one less click or you used one more credit. So between each action, try to leave 1 second of delay. Another very common action that you're going to be doing is discarding a card from either the table or your hand. To discard a card, simply mouse over the card. Let's say that we get another credit, and now we don't have any more clicks, we're supposed to end our turn. But our hand size is 5, and we have 7 cards in our hand, so we have to discard down to 5. So let's say we want to discard our Junebug and the data mine. You could drag in the card into your archives, but I would really suggest you don't do this because there's a script running in the background and you might disrupt them. This is actually much easier to simply mouse over the card and press the delete button. This will automatically send the card where it needs to be. You can also right click on the card and trash or archive it, but pressing the delete button is just easier. Once you've finished with your turn, it's time to move to the next player. So, to do that, you go again to the turns and clicks, and you declare the end of your turn. Press F12. So, let's do this now. The game will actually check that it is that you don't have more cards in your hand than you need, and will move the turn order to the next player, as you can see here. The game will inform the other player that it's his turn, so they can start their turn. Similarly, the runner plays exactly the same way, F1 to start. If your turn has already reached, F1 will not put another of these messages, so don't have to worry about it. It will just inform the other player how many much money you have at the start of your turn, how many clicks. So in a very similar way, let's do it very quickly. Double click to draw a card, Control C to take a credit. Let's take two more credits. And now let's see what happens if we try to end our turn with more cards than our hand maximum. Press F12. And the game pops up a warning message. You have more cards in your hand. When you see a pop-up window, it is always something important. Please take the effort to read it. If it's a one-time thing like a warning, you won't see it again. But if it's there, take a few seconds to actually read what it's saying. In this case, it's telling you that you have more cards than your hand maximum of 5. So, discard enough and then declare the end of the turn action again. You will also notice that the game did not move to the next player. We're still on our turn. So, let's press F2, let's discard the card that we don't want. Let's discard the Whirp for now. Mouse over. If you see this error on the chat box, there's nothing to worry about. The game just realized that there's something broken with one of your cards and automatically fixed it. Now that you discarded your card, press F12 again and we go back to the first player. If you want, you can mouse over the tab, you can see how many cards they have and their agenda, their archives and how many cards they have in their deck. So let's go back to the corporation. Okay, so you saw a basic functions for both players. So now let's see the corporation turn and the thing specific to that. So first of all, as a corporation, you will have your identity on the table. This will be set up during the setup of the game. This usually, if it has any automatic ability like Jinteki, will work by itself. You don't really need to do anything about it. Same goes for all the other corporations. Hasbiro will automatically give you a credit. Wayland will automatically give you a credit when you play transactions. And NBN will automatically pay for the traces if you go over the trace strength. Other than your ability, we have your central servers. Your HQ, your R&D, your archives. There's nothing behind them. This is the slot where you're going to put your upgrades if you have any. And finally, on the side here, we have the virus purge count card. You can use this to purge all viruses from the game. And your trace card, which is not you're not going to use very often because the trace starts automatically usually. Now we see what we have on the starting of the player. A very useful thing you can do as a new player is you can right-click on the table, go to Help and References. You can see here various helping cards. This is taken directly from the manual of the game. These are things you can use to help you keep up with the rules, or if you're a newer player, help you play the game. For example, the Corp Action Reminder will put this classic card on the table, and if you mouse over the card, you will be able to see it in a higher version. This works for every card. You probably saw it already. If you mouse over any card, you will get a larger version of it, so you can read it better. If for some reason you have you cannot read a card, let's say because you have a censored version of a set, the game provides you an alternative. Merely right-click on any of your cards and select Inspect. This will pop up a window. It will show you the ability, the card text, and will inform you if it has any automations. So if I right click on this card and I inspect, it will tell us that this card will perform one or more automated actions when you double click on it. So this way you know that if your card has any special abilities that will work automatically. Jinteki will have a continuous effect while in play. If you want to inspect your opponent's cards, it's a bit trickier because you cannot actually get the options when you right-click on opponent's cards. Instead, you have to use a little workaround, which is through the targeting. The targeting works as follows. Shift and click on one of your cards, one of the cards in the table, you can target it. And targeting puts this little cursor on top of the card that allows you to then do more scripts, have those scripts affect the card you have targeted. So this is the way that you tell the game, I want to do something on that card. In this case, we want to inspect it. So the same way that you inspected your own card, which is Control I or the inspect, you can inspect this card. Obviously, you cannot target it, you cannot right click on it, but if you right click on the table, you can have the inspect option, and you can see inspect target, which anything you see has the target, you need to actually have a target selected. Let's do it. And now you can see your opponent's cards as well. If you press yes, this will take you to cardgamedb.com to the online version of the card. To play your cards, as always, the easiest way is to double click. You know that you have 3-5 different types of cards, so I won't go into details about that. But there's a difference in how each of them reacts when you double click on it. When you double click on a nice, let's do it now. Oh, here we go. The game informs us that we didn't actually press F1 to start our turn. You should not forget it. At the start of your turn, the very first thing you need to do is press F1. If you see this message, press no, I didn't remember to press F1, press F1, and then you can start. As you can see, this also does our mandatory draw, so it ensures that we won't forget to draw our cards. Okay, so let's see if what happens if I play the ice. I double click on my ice. The ice is automatically placed on the table. You see, it is placed usually firstly in front of your headquarters. And as is usual with engines like this, you can drag and drop any card on the table. So I can take this ice and drag it in front of another server. So if you wanted to play this ice in front of your archives, let's say, you just drag it, put it in front of archives. This is one of the few manual things in the game, is repositioning your cards. You have to do this. So let's see what happens if we play an asset. The asset is placed in the asset, in the root area of the server, and you can now you have a new remote server. If we play, let's say, an agenda on top, it's going to be placed slightly next to it. This doesn't mean that you should leave it like this, because this looks like an upgrade. So again, take the card, drag it until it's at the right distance next to it. Once you have an asset on the table, you need to signify to the runner that there's a new remote server there, like the same way that you have your central server. To do that, right click on the table, create new remote server. Ta-da! You will put a remote server where it expects your its new remote server to be. You can press it again, create new remote server. If you can press it again, now you have an empty one. You're not allowed to have empty remote servers. So if you, for example, have a remote server that got its asset trust, you can just mouse over it, press delete, it will disappear. Okay, so we played all our actions. And we played an ice and two assets. Let's go back to the runner side and continue from there. It's the end of our turn, so we press F12 to end our turn. So as a runner, it's our turn, we press F1. If you press a key and it doesn't work, click on the table once and then press it. It may be that the keyboard is focused on another window, so just make sure that Octagon has the focus. So as a runner, we have our different kind of cards. In this case, we have only programs and Steam Hack on the table, on our hand. And again, to play them is, as you would expect, simply double click on them. So let's play our Crypsis. Now, the Clipsis appears on the top row, which is reserved for our programs. And you can see here that our first click was used to play Clipsis for 5 credits, and it uses up one memory unit. So you see here that your memory units start at 4, now are 3, because we played our program. If we play yet another program, it's going to go down to 2. Okay, so let's use our last two actions to refill our hand. Double click, double click. F12, we signify we have ended our turn. Let's go back to the court. F1, we start our turn. Okay, how do you res your assets? Quite easy, as before. If you double click on an asset, it will res it. You double click on it, it pays the cost to res it. So you can see it on the chat. And now Melanzo, a mining corp, has the ability that we can use 3 credits, 3 clicks to gain 7 credits. We could do it manually and say, I put my clicks to 0 and you go minus 1, 2, 3 and then put 7 here. So do the calculation, 6 plus 7, 13. Or we can do it the easiest way, which is, let's put it back as it was. We simply double click on Melanzo. Ta-da. Game informs 3 clicks. I use the triple click 1, 2, 3 and I activate Melanzo Mining Corp in order to gain 7 credits. So F12, we end our turn. It's time for the runner. As a runner, you have your various events and cards. So let's see if we can find some programs. Let's first start F1. Let's find some different kind of cards. Okay, so there's a resource. When you get a resource, you can simply double click on it. You will play it on the table. It will go on the bottom location, which is reserved for the resources of the runner. And let's see if we can find some hardware as well. Okay, so we got some interesting cards in our hand and we can now play, see how the events and the hardware works. So to play an event, simply double click on the event and will take effect. You can see here the game informs you to play Sur Gamble, and then this little arrow means it's an automated ability, so you gain 9 credits. You can see your credits reflect that. To play hardware, simply double click on it. It will go in the hardware slot. Resource, like Armitage, you double click on it, it goes in the resource slot next to our GlobalSec. So when you play programs, resource, hardware, you don't have to rearrange them. They will usually fall in the right location for you to use. And like most other cards, code items, code busting, you can use by simply double clicking on it. There we go. So let's go back to the corporation. Okay, F1 to start our turn. Okay. So as a corporation, we can also use operations. Just double click on them. And now we have agendas. How do we advance agendas? The easiest way is you right click on the card, go to add remove markers, and the very first one is pay 1 credit and 1 click and you advance a card. It's quite more easy to simply mouse over the card and press Alt and A. Just don't do it too fast. And this is the way you advance your cards. The opponent does not know if this is an agenda or an asset, but they can find out with exposing it or running on it. So we saw advancing, let's see how we score. Scoring is easy. As soon as you have all the advancement counters on your card, in this case it costs 5, double click on it, it will try to score it. And then you can press yes. In this case, priority requisition is the kind of card that requires you that can res an ice for free. So if you have a priority requisition to be resed and you haven't targeted an ice to res for free, the game will inform you, will tell you that, hey, you possibly forgot to do something. Do you want to proceed anyway? If you press no, it will just undo the action and you have an opportunity to do it now. So let's do it correctly. Let's target our unresed ice. Double click on our agenda. The game will ask us if we want to score it. The card is scored. Now, here's something interesting. If you remember, I'm playing Jinteki. Jinteki has the ability that does automatic net damage every time I score an agenda. Every time, the first time you do a damage of any type, the game will put this warning window. This will allow you to an opportunity to realize that you're doing damage and to warn your opponent via voice chat that you're about to inflict damage on them. Once you are ready to inflict the damage, you can either press yes, so that you will get this pop-up window again next time, or you can press no, so that it will be done automatically. At the start, I suggest you always press yes, so that you have an opportunity to inform your opponent that you're going to do damage, so that they can trigger automated abilities that prevent damage. Now, what happened when you did damage? The game went automatically to the opponent, chose a random card from the hand, and discarded it. If we move to the tab of our opponent, normally you'll be here, you go here, you can see the discard pile. If you want to see what has been discarded by the opponent, right-click on the discard pile and look at all cards. And you can see them in the order they've been discarded. You can do the same on their deck or their hidden archives, but unless you have a card effect that allows you to do it, do not. The game will also inform the opponent if you try to do it. Now, what we didn't explain is what happens if you try to res an agenda without having the money for it. We haven't explained what will happen to an agenda if you try to score it without having enough advancement. So let's play an agenda. So let's say that I put one advancement counter and I try to double click on it. The game will inform us you have not advanced enough and you didn't score it. Due to various card effects that the game cannot recognize yet, this might be possible. For example, if you have an asset or an upgrade that allows you to score with less advancements. If you have such an asset, you can press yes and merely inform your opponent that you're going to use your asset. Okay, so now we see how we can score the agendas. Every time you score an agenda, you will see that this little counter will increase. Once this reaches 7 points, the game will declare you the winner and will also record your statistics. One more thing that you should know when playing ice is that because where you play your ice is manual, the game does not know if you're playing ice on the same server. So if you play an ice and you want to put it on top of an existing ice, you will have to do the calculation of how much money you have to pay for the install. In this case, I put it in front of my Enigma, so I have one more ice, I can just reduce it by one. If I installed my Wall of Thorns on top of those, I would have to reduce it by two. Resing ice is the same as an asset, you just double click on the ice and it will be raised. Of course, you're not allowed to do this outside of a run, but if at any point you have to res the ice, for example, like fourth activation orders, or the runner is approaching the ice, just double click on it, it will pay the cost as long as you have the money, and turn it face up. Now, if you have operations like precognition that you want to play, and these operations do something that is far too difficult to do it automatically. So in this case, precognition, when you play it, it won't do actually anything, but it will inform the opponent that it goes on the table, that you played it, and you can then use the ability manually. How to do it manually? In the case of precognition, it allows you to look at the top 5 cards of your R&D and arrange them in any order. So right click on your R&D, look at top X cards, we look at 5, we can see the top 5 cards, we can rearrange them any order we want. And when you're done, close the window. Operations, you can either discard them manually by pressing the delete button, or they will be discarded automatically at the end of your turn, as soon as you press F12. Now, something interesting, when I played direct precognition, I didn't have enough credits. The message popped up and said, do you want to bypass not having enough credits? And I pressed yes. When you do actually do that, the game will put your credit counter at -1, so that you know you exceeded your maximum. Due, for example, to a card effect if you have it, and will also inform the opponent that, hey, this player played a click that he didn't have. It allows you to do it because you may have a card effect that allows you, and perhaps that card effect is not scripted correctly or not scripted yet. So you always have the freedom to do it manually, just inform your opponent why you have this opportunity if they don't understand. Another important thing you need to know as a corporation is how to remove viruses. To remove viruses, you have this little card right here that as soon as you double click, it will go through the game and remove all the virus tokens. Virus tokens are the green ones. So, if at any point you have to wipe the all viruses, see that you haven't used any actions, and double-click the card. The game will inform what you did. Now, another classic thing a corporation does is trash resources from the runner if they don't have, if they are tagged. If they're not tagged and you try to trash a resource, you won't be able to do it. So, if I want to trash a resource, I target it, and then I go pay and trash target, resource, asset, or upgrade. In this case, we want to trash a resource. So I try to click on it, and it tells us that we cannot trash unless the runner has a tag. We can bypass the restriction in case we have a card effect in the game. In this case, we choose no. So let's see what happens if we have, if the runner has a tag and we try to do this. Pay and trash target. It will go there, delete the access from Globasec, and it will also reduce the runner's link. Finally, another very important thing that you usually do as a corporation is that you want to res various assets just before your turn starts. For example, a pad campaign. A pad campaign, you want to res it just before you start your turn so that it can pay for itself a bit before the runner trashes it, if they're going to trash it. In which case, what you want to do is, once the runner has gone to sleep, you double click on your asset to res it. This doesn't cost you a click. And then you press F1. And then you will see that you have start or 10 effects. In this case, the pad campaign gives you one, and then you have your mandatory draw. Easy peasy. Finally, if you want to play an upgrade on one of your servers, you play the same way as any other asset, double click on it, put it on a server. You probably want to put it along with an asset or an agenda, so you can just move it slightly to the bottom, and if you want, you can send to back. Just make sure that you don't move your cards after you play them, so that the runner can keep track of which card is where, in case they've exposed one in the past. Okay, as a runner now, you have your identity, and again, this works the same way as the corporation. If it has an automated ability like noises, it will automatically work. Noises, for example, ability allows you to trash a card whenever you play a virus. So if I play a medium, let's see what happens in the corporation's discard pile. The top card is the precognition, and they have four cards in their archive. So I play my medium. And you can see in the automated, in the chat menu, I activate my trash, my noise, to trash one card from the corporation R&D. And I activate my grimoire to put a virus counter. So this happens automatically. And we can see now the corporation has trashed the card. Another important thing you're going to be doing as a runner is hosting cards on other cards. The most classic example is hosting a data sucker on Engine. Now if you have a daemon, it's very easy to host a card in it. Simply target it before you play your card. Play your card. It will be played in a normal location. And it will automatically take a daemon MU. This will make sure that the card doesn't use any memory units. So you can see here we still have 3 memory units because we have in total 6. 6 minus 1, 2, 3 equals 3. Another type of hosting of that you might do is hosting a parasite on an opponent's ice. In which case you want to target the ice and play your parasite. Double click on it. If once you play your parasite, it might be worth it to bring it to the top so you can see how many virus counters it has. In which case, right click on it and bring it to front. And then you can keep track of how long it will take for the parasite to trash the parent ice. Let's see what would happen if we haven't targeted anything with the parasite. So if I try to play and I don't have any ice targeted, parasite will abort. It will tell you need a valid card before using this action. You need an ice. You need to be raised. Aborting. If I target an unraised ice, for example, again, parasite won't play. So make sure that you're targeting the right card to play your parasites first. And then page up, we can bring it up. The runner has various other actions in his repertoire, like exposing cards. For example, the classic infiltration card allows us to see what a card face down from the opponent is. Let's say that we want to see this upgrade. We target it, we play our infiltration. Now, infiltration and generally exposing effects don't work automatically. This is to prevent you from doing a mistake or doing it too fast without giving the opportunity to the opponent to react. When you actually do an exposing effect, the game will just inform the opponent that you intend to expose it, and with point they can either expose it or cancel it with an effect like Zai Back to Loyalty. In this case, let's say that we don't have an effect to prevent exposing, so that the corporation is going to let it. So we right click on the card and we select expose. The card gets a white background, which means that it's simply revealed, not actually in the game. And once the player has seen what it is, we can just unexpose it. It's exactly the same action and just turns it face down. To clear a targeting from you or from your opponent, merely shift click again on the targeting, on the targeted card. Very similar to the corporation, to activate one of your cards, if the card has a special ability, like an icebreaker or Carbita Scott Busting or anything generally that is not automated, you merely just have to double click on it. In this case, for example, for the Carbita Scott Busting, just double click on it to get the credits. On the other hand, automated effects or effects that refill credits also work automatically during of our turn, start of turn. So if when I press F1, you will notice in the chat that Wildside triggers automatically to draw two cards into my hand. Wildside triggers to make me lose one click. The Cyber triggers to refill its credits. And the Parasite puts automatically a counter. Card effects like Parasite, which trash ice, won't work automatically. So make sure that you keep track of how many counters it has. And when you have enough to trash an ice, you can simply either ask your opponent to do it, or you can do it yourself. How to trash an opponent's cards? If you just target it, right click on the table, trash target for free, which is what we need to do. If you actually try to pay for it, the game will warn you that this is not a card that you are allowed to trash. So we trash for free. The game will inform you once again. If you trash an opponent's card because it might disrupt various things in the game, it will automatically trigger any scripts about cards leaving play. The game will make sure that you are allowed to do it. So we press yes. And we see that even though we didn't trash the Parasite, because it host left, it went automatically to the discard pile. Same thing will happen if we use the Djinn. For example, if my Djinn is hosting the medium and the data sucker, and my opponent trashes it, all of the problems get discarded. Okay, so let's move now to the meat of a runner's experience, which is the actual run. When you want to start a run on the opposing servers, the very first thing you need to do is select where you want to run. If you run on a central server, you can merely use the run on one of the HQ, R&D and archives option, and the game will automatically announce it in the chat. As a common courtesy, you may want to target the server so the opponent is crystal clear where you're going. You should always target the remote server if you're running on it, so the game so that the opponent understands where you're going. So in this case, let's see how we can run on its server. To start a run on R&D, we go to runner actions and go run on R&D. The game will take one of our clicks to start a run on the R&D. So once you start a run, you have to let the corporation know which size you're approaching. The easiest way To put that is by using the targeting arrow. To use the targeting arrow, merely shift click on your identity or any other card, but for this purpose we want the identity, and then drag your mouse cursor over the card you want to target. This will create a nice looking arrow, which is actually quite useful for the corporation to know what you're currently accessing or approaching. Now, once the corporation is clear where you are, they have a chance to raise their eyes. To raise their eyes, we simply double click on the card. So in this case, it's a neural katana. As a runner, we happen to have the proper icebreaker for this katana. So let's double click on our icebreaker. And the game automatically uses the credit to announce that we're breaking the subroutine. Doesn't actually compare anything or make sure that your strength is enough. You have to make sure of that by yourself. But it does automatically use money from cards like Cyberfeeder or bad publicity. So now you told the opponent that you managed to break his katana. We can now access R&D. First of all, once you make a successful run, the very first thing you want to do is press F3. F3 will announce that you succeeded the run, and it will then take the automatic action depending on which server you have been running on. In the case of an R&D, it will look at the top one card of your... it will ask you how many cards you want to look, and depending on card effects you have, such as a medium, you can look at one or more cards. In this case, pressing F3 automatically put an extra virus token on our medium. You now get this confirmation. It has a bit of fluff text, and then it says, asks you if you want to proceed to access R&D. We press yes, we do want to access R&D. How many mid counters does my medium have? It has 2. So I'm going to access 2 cards. Press OK. Now, the game starts automatically accessing the cards. In this case, we got an ambush. An ambush will pop up a window that, and when you see such a window, when you see a window start with ambush, you should not immediately press yes. You should read what it has to say and give the opportunity to the opponent to trigger the ambush. In this case, you have hit a snare. The snare, the opponent has to decide to pay it or not. So if you actually press yes now, the snare will be removed from the table and the opponent won't have the time to do anything. As a corporation, on the other hand, if you see the runner has played one of your cards, has hit one of your traps, the card will appear on the table with a white background, and all you have to do is merely double click on it. Your money will be taken and it will start applying its damage to the opponent. As a runner, you're going to see your cards going away from your hand, and you're going to see that you got damage for 3 points of damage. Now, once the snare has been activated, press yes to continue. And now you get a second option where you get the opportunity to see the card that you are accessing and choose what you want to do. In this case, you can see the card text, the type, keywords, cost, trust to trust, and any card text it has. In this case, it costs only 0 to trust. You will always have the leave it where it is and the force trust at no cost options. This is true on any card you are accessing, either headquarters, R&D, or remote server. Leave it where it is, we'll do what it says. If it's a card in headquarters, we'll go back to the hunt. If it's a remote server, we'll stay back where it was, in the same state it was, rest or unrest. If it's in R&D, it will go back to the position that it was. Force trust at no cost, we'll always trust the card, no matter what kind of card it is. So only use this card if you have an ability that allows you to trust a card, for example, a demolition run or an imp. Pay 0 to trust will only appear, or pay any number to trust, will only appear if you are allowed to trust a card, if it's an asset, or upgrade, or anything that has a trust cost. In this case, the snare costs only 0 to trust, so there's no reason why not to trust it. So we press that, the snare is trust. The next card goes automatically to this window, because it's what you might want to activate at R&D access. So we merely press 0 to trust it. Now we have finished our run to the R&D. Now, once you finish a run with F3, you have to press escape to jack out. This is also in the runner action, jack out. Pressing escape will clear all your targeting and will take automatic effects from the game. Now let's see a run on headquarters. Runner actions, run on headquarters. Again, we point out where we're accessing. The corporation has a chance to raise, but since they don't have enough money, they cannot do it. So now we tell them that we're accessing the next dice. Now that we're accessing the second dice, which is this, we can again break its subroutines. The game will allow you to actually click an icebreaker that you're not allowed to and use it, but you're not supposed to do that. So just because the game allows you to double click on a card and claim that you're using it, it doesn't actually compare the icebreaker you're accessing. So you need to keep track of this. In this case, the only way we can break Datamine is with Eclipses. Let's say that we don't want to do this because we want to keep our Eclipses for Enigma. In which case, the corporation has a chance to trigger the subroutines. The subroutine of Datamine says, do one the damage and trust Datamine. How do we do that? We just double click on the Datamine. Any subroutine from an ice, any, we can activate by simply double clicking on it. Yes. The game, in the chat menu, you will see we applied one damage and we trust the Datamine to do the damage. Simply drag your previous ice a bit down. Another runner again accesses the next ice. So, first the runner has the opportunity to use their icebreakers. In this case, Crypsis has only 0 strength and Enigma has 2 strength. Let's say that Crypsis, we want to break this subroutine with Crypsis. In which case, we double click on our Crypsis to start breaking this ice. As you double click on an icebreaker that has various abilities, a control window, an icebreaker GUI will open and will allow you to select which abilities you want to use and how many times. This is an actual multiple choice menu, so you can click any of these abilities as many times as you want. In this case, we want to increase the strength of our Crypsis by 2. And we want to break 2 ice subroutines. So we click 2 and 2. Since we don't have any virus to remove, we don't use this action, but we'll have to trust Crypsis manually. So we finish our selection, and once we press this button, all these abilities that we triggered will happen immediately. So now you see in the chat menu, 2 times we paid 1 to activate Crypsis, 2 times we activate Crypsis to put a break a nice subroutine. So Crypsis is trust because it didn't have any virus counters, so we can just mouse over Crypsis, press delete, and it is trust, and our memory units are returned. And on the other hand, we passed the ice, so we can now press F3 to access the headquarters. So we press F3 and you get again this a different window. It explains that you're accessing headquarters, access to headquarters granted, and you can press yes or no to access. And we want to access. Pressing yes will automatically pick a random card from the corporation's hand and will give us again the familiar window to select what we want to do. In this case, it's an operation, so we don't have the option to pay to trust it. So we have to leave it where it is. If we had done the demolition run, we would be able to force trust it at no cost. And again, we finished our run successfully. We press escape to complete it. Now, runners have events that allow them to run by themselves, such as the demolition run or the steam hack. These events automatically start a run, and quite often you can choose where you want to go, or they will go in automatically in one location. In the case of steam hack, it will allow us to go anywhere we want. So let's say that we wanted to go and trust this Mylanze Mining Corp. We first play our Yogg to be able to break some code gates. And then we start a run with a steam hack. Now, if you play the steam hack without targeting a server, it will automatically ask you where you want to go. So let's try this now. pop-up window, we want to go to a remote server. So when you actually want to run with such a card, it's better to first target where you want to go, and this will make it easier. This will automatically make the game understand the target and inform your opponent as well. So once again, we're approaching the first dice. The corporation has a chance to raise, and they choose to raise. And it's a hunter. A hunter is a strength force sentry, so our mimic cannot break it. However, if we use the ability of Data Sagger, we can. So once again, we target first, and we double click. Notice that I had two targets selected, and yet Data Sagger knew to put it on the ice and not on the server. The game will usually take the right decision if you have multiple targets. You should get nevertheless in the habit of clearing your targets if you don't need them, because in case, for example, I had two eyes selected, the counter from Data Sagger would go to only one, and it will choose pretty randomly. So if you're going to target an ability, make sure that you have only the target that you want selected. So now we managed to bring the strength of the hunter to 3, and let's use our mimic to break it. Now we're approaching the next dice. The corporation decides to raise a chum. A chum has a strength of 4, so our yoke cannot break it. Let's say that we don't have any more Data Suckers. So we have to take the ability. In this case, in the case of the Chama's ability, it allows the next dice to get +2 strength. So as the corporation, we doubly click on our next dice, and we put a +2 strength on the target dice. And we don't use this ability yet, because we haven't seen if they can be if they will be able to break it. However, this agility exists on the Cham, because it's not possible to put extra subroutines on your other eyes. So, in case as a corporation, you're supposed to use this ability if the runner can't break the next subroutine of the next ice. So, plus the token goes on our ice. The runner decides to play through. So, once again, we raise our ice. Now, as a runner, this has a 6 strength, so we cannot break it with a mimic. So the subroutines of the hunter and Cham are going to take place. In the case, first of all, the ability of Cham goes off, because that is a constant ability. So we double click on the Cham, and we select inflict 3 net damage. I will go to the opponent player, and we'll discard 3 cards from the hand. And now our hand is empty. Finally, we can now use the subroutine to trace the runner. So we double click on our hunter. And since our hunter only has one subroutine, it won't give us a pop-up window to ask us which one we use, and we'll only use the same one. In this case, we want to increase the strength of... We have the opportunity to increase the strength of the trace. Now that we click the hunter, we can increase the strength of our trace. So our counter has a strength of 3 for the trace. If you don't remember that your trace strength, you can just press X and it will cancel the trace attempt. Move over, see what the hunter does. Once you're ready, double click on it. And let's say we want to increase our trace strength by 2. The game will inform you that you have a trace strength of total 5, because 3 cards from the hunter itself reinforced by 2 credits, so a total of 5. As a runner, if you're being traced, you have the opportunity to use your trace card to boost your link. The trace card will use any available base link you have, in this case 0, plus any money that you pay. So let's say I don't want to pay to boost it. I put 0. The game announces our total value for a total of 0, and since we were traced, we get automatically the effects from Hunter, which is giving us a tag. So if you didn't notice it, let's try it again. 0. Here we go. We get a tag. And finally, we managed to access the server, since then none of these eyes managed to end the run. So, what do? We target a card, and we want to access it. To access a card, right-click on the table, and access target, or press Ctrl-Enter. The familiar window will pop up, and will give you an option, the options you know and love. In this case, you can leave it where it is, you can force trust it at no cost, but you don't have an effect that allows you to do that, or you can pay zero to trust. Now this is zero because it's one minus one. The minus one comes from many cost reducing effects that are in the table. For example, the Steam hack. Clicking that takes a credit from the Steam hack and says that we actually paid zero from our personal credits. Let's say that we run on the other remote server. In this case, we would target both of the cards and we'd press Ctrl-Enter. The game would go one by one and start seeing what they are. In this case, it would be a pad campaign, so we can pay zero to trust it by using the credits from SteamHack, and then we can pay zero to trust the Kitaro. If the card is an agenda, using the familiar action gives us an option. The third option now becomes Liberate. Liberating the card scores the agenda for the runner and puts it in your pile. So let's do it now. You get a message that you're going to inflict automatic damage. This is because the Jinteki ability will damage you every time you steal one of their agendas. We want to see this message again, and our single card is discarded. Since this was a Steam hack run, and the run is going to deal us a brain damage. Normally, if we had any cards in our hand, this wouldn't kill us, but it would reduce our maximum hand size. In this case, since we do not have any cards in our hand, a Steam hack is going to flatline us. And let's see how it works. We press escape. Game tells us we're going to take damage. Yes. And we have flatline. You get here, you see a message, DB0 has flatlined. Of course, a runner can also win by scoring those agendas. So let's take the scenario that we had enough cards in our hand to pass through these servers. And let's see what happens. So with our first run, let's do a run on the remote server. We press F5. There's no eyes to stop us, so we immediately press F3 to signify that we did a successful run. We target the card, we press Ctrl-Enter. We can liberate the card. Take our damage. And let's say we press Escape. We finish the run. We do another run on the other remote server. We tell them we go here. Let's say they're tracing us. In this case, let's say that we want to fight the trace, so we pay 3. And you can see here that we now have evaded the trace. So we go on. Some fires off. We go on. We take the 3 damage from the charm. And then we get another trace. This time we won't pay for it. So we get a tag. And now we can access. And there we go. Now the game instead reports that we liberate the agenda and we win the game. Same way the corporation can win by scoring 7 points. And there you have it. Now you have know the basics of playing the game. As an addendum, I'm going to mention a few other interesting things that may help you play. First, we have manipulating the table view. So you can zoom in and out by scrolling the mouse, which can give you a better view of the table, but most of the time this is not really needed because you can simply mouse over any card to see it. You can also pan the table by pressing space and then dragging your mouse around. Clicking and dragging with your mouse. If you notice, next to your name you have the global pile. The global pile contains this pile which is called Exile. This is where, for example, agendas eaten by an archer go. So, in case you want to find such agendas, go look here. Finally, the way to restart the game if you want to play a rematch with the other player is to use the reset button. The reset button will unload all the cards from the game, so both players will be without a deck. And this is not something you can reverse, so if you press the reset button, there's no going back. In this case, let's do it, and you can see how it works. So we reset. The game will make sure that you want to do it. and as you see, everything's clear. So now you can load again another deck, and again press setup. Yes. And there we go. And with this, the introduction to using the Octagon Android Netrunner plugin is finished. I hope this has shown you the most efficient ways to play the game. And I will follow up with a video in the future, which will show you a bit more naturally a few starting turns between the corporation and the runner, so you can get an idea of how the plugin works when used efficiently. Until then, happy running!